Greetings. Welcome to another edition of Celebrate Life. I'm Wayne Braverman, and it is my great honor and privilege to be with you today. We're filming this on a very hot, humid summer day. Matter of fact, it's so hot and humid, I am even wearing shorts in the studio. That's the only look of my legs you're going to get, because I promised I would not do that to you and gross you all out. But summer is such a wonderful time of year. Great weather, vacations, and hopefully a chance to have a lot of fun. We all need time to relax, recharge, and rejuvenate ourselves, especially these days. For 15 years, one of the ways that I did that was as co-director of a week-long creative arts camp in Rhode Island. The Living Arts program was something very special. The kids, who were in grades 3 through 12 and came from many different backgrounds and many different places, really had a great time during this week. The camp was so popular that during many of the years, we actually had a waiting list of kids trying to come. We offered many programs during this week, from photography to cooking, clowning, theater, writing, poetry, music, puppetry, dance, international culture, nature, and of course, all kinds of different arts and crafts. But in addition to that, we also included a theme that focused on helping the kids to learn about life and the nature of God, especially since it was a Christian camp. One of the years I remember the most is the one where I saw a large group of children and young adults come together all on their own, showing us, the adults, how the world can really be. My fellow co-director and I, a woman named Kathleen, we picked as our theme that year, Gifts from the Heart. This was all about learning how to give and receive from others, and how to give and receive ourselves. It was all about accepting each other for who we are and doing our part to help make this a better world. Now, the highlight of the camp was to come on Wednesday, the fourth day of camp. We found this very experiential game called Save the World. Kathleen took part in a version of this exercise a year earlier at a program she attended, and she thought that it could work great in camp. We worked for several months putting this and other activities related to the theme together. We adapted Save the World for the Living Arts Camp, adding a lot more teeth to it than it originally had. The kids were going to be broken up into several different groups and go from station to station to take part in different exercises that would be fun, educational, and hopefully filled with a lot of meaning. But one of the lessons we learned as camp directors throughout our years was that no matter what we planned, we always needed to be flexible because the unknown was sure to show up. And if you've ever worked with kids, or for that matter, any group, you know that that is always a possibility. And sure enough, every year we had to change something in our program. Sometimes it was weather related. Sometimes it was because a counselor or a teacher had something come up, and sometimes it was just because you're dealing with a lot of kids. And when you're dealing with a lot of kids, flexibility is a must. And of course, every year we saw God at work in amazing ways we never would have expected. During our first full night of camp, the campers were eating outdoors for the first course in what was to be a four-course progressive dinner. Each living unit was going to have the chance to be our host for a portion of that dinner. Their job was to help us make us feel welcomed and to help make this a special time. That first course, the appetizer, was hosted by the elementary school-aged campers. Turned out to be pretty special, but not as it was planned. Just as we were getting started, a rabid fox came dashing out of the woods, attacked one of the campers' backpacks, which were lined up along the edge of a large field, and he dragged it away into the woods. That was not part of the planned program, not at all. Of course, we had to bring everyone indoors for safety, and we brought them into a giant auditorium called the Great Hall, which was located in the camp's main building complex. To make things even a bit more interesting, on this particular day, the camp's resident director and his staff were locked away with a team from the American Camping Association. For the first time, the camp was going for ACA certification, and this was their final evaluation meeting. That meant the regular summer staff was not available to us, and it was up to us, the Living Arts volunteers, to run the entire camp for the day. We called the town's animal control officer, who came by armed with his rifle. I walked with him through the woods, and we went looking for the fox. We didn't find him. The animal control officer said to me, "Well, that fox probably just go deep into the woods and die within a day or two. Chances are you won't see him again. You'll probably be okay and safe with outdoor activities. I wouldn't worry about it at all. You'll be fine." We kept the 140 campers inside for the night activities and created a talent show to entertain them. Later, we were ready to send the kids to bed. The senior high campers lived in dorms down the hall from the Great Hall in the main building. They liked that because it had electricity, which was great for their hair dryers and other electrical things that kept them entertained. Elementary campers lived a short distance away in beautiful, fairly new lakefront cabins. It was the middle school campers who had the longest journey to one of the most remote parts of the camp. They needed to walk back a half mile to the deep woods where they were to sleep in large tents on giant platforms. They were called hogans. We dismissed the middle school kids first since they had the longest distance to travel. A short ways out the Great Hall, that rabid fox that we were told we would not see again leapt out of the woods trying to grab a beach towel out of the hands of the first girl in line. He scratched that poor child pretty deep and he ran off. All the kids came back into the Great Hall. That poor camper who was scratched was a girl named Sarah. I never wanted any camper or any adult to get hurt, but especially this girl. She was born with a lot of health challenges that, among other things, affected her growth. She was in the process of going through a series of operations to extend her spine. Of course, we needed to contact her parents to tell them what happened with the fox, and we needed to send her to the hospital to be treated. Sarah was very upset and crying. At that time, in those moments, she had the power to affect the entire camp. Had she said she was scared and wanted to go home, we were absolutely sure that many of the other campers would also say they were scared and they wanted to go home. She did the opposite. She was crying not because she wanted to go home, but because she didn't want to go home and she didn't want to go to the hospital. She said that she was more worried and sad about the fox being sick than she was about what happened to her. Sarah's parents left the final decision to Sarah. We did take her to the hospital emergency room where they dressed her wounds and started her rabies shots. And then she came back to the camp. She stayed the entire week. That week, not one camper asked to go home. Not one. even with that rabid fox running around. That night, the middle school campers had to sleep on the floor of the Great Hall. We certainly couldn't send them back into the deep woods to sleep, not with that fox still running around. Staffers went up in vans to try to collect the campers' things from the Hogans, which, by the way, was not easy either because they didn't know if they were going to come across the fox. But meanwhile, back in the Great Hall, the senior high campers went back down to their dorm rooms and came back carrying their own mattresses, pillows, stuffed animals, an assortment of other things, including food that they weren't supposed to have in their rooms. But they did all this to help those middle school campers. They stayed with those kids, telling them stories, singing songs with them, trying to get them to relax, trying to get them to laugh. Those senior high campers did everything they could to help the younger campers feel safe and comfortable. And here's the amazing thing about it. They did all that on their own. No adult suggested that they do this. No adult said, hey, it would be nice if you go bring your mattress and pillow down for these poor junior high kids. No. The senior high campers did this completely on their own, and they took care of those middle school kids every night. And on the next day, the middle school campers started looking after the elementary school campers. That was something they did entirely on their own. They wanted to pass along the gift of caring and kindness they had received from the senior high campers onto our youngest campers. We, the adults, were absolutely amazed. The kindness and the caring these kids showed for each other was incredible. Of course, the programs that Kathleen and I had spent 8 months planning out, they all had to be changed since outdoor activities were pretty limited. And there were signs every day that the fox was still around, even though we were told he wouldn't be. We found signs such as chewed up bike tires, some ripped clothes, and other assorted things. But on Thursday, right before lunch, the resident director found the fox. The fox was dead, on the ground, within 15 feet of the camp's health lodge. The fox was even facing the health lodge like the fox was going there. Kids were invited to see the now deceased fox if they wanted to. Many of them did. Many of the kids also wanted to hold a funeral for the fox. We said no. The fox needed to be taken away to be tested for rabies, and sure enough, it did have rabies. We never did get to play the game of life, but we didn't need to. Those campers played it for real. They stepped up and shared with each other the true gifts from the heart. We talked about it with them, and we hope that what they learned during that week, what they did during that week, was something that they would always remember and take back into the world with them. Those campers got to experience firsthand how even the smallest acts of generosity, empathy, and kindness can make such a great big difference. That's what it's like to change and to save the world. For that week, at Camp Aldersgate in North Scituate, Rhode Island, a group of kids of all ages changed their part of the world. We all have the power every day in our lives to save the world. You might be saying, yeah, right. No, I can't, darn politicians. Yes, you can. One of the traditions at Camp Aldersgate. If someone wants to get the attention of the campers, we use this sign. It's sign language for I love you. It works much better than, hey, be quiet, or put a lid on it, or even worse, shut the heck up and listen. Nah, this works much better. We need a world with a lot more empathy, compassion, and love in it. Imagine what the world would be like if we actually listened and tried to understand each other, even if we disagree with them. Imagine if we tried to do more to help those who are hurting and in need, instead of just ignoring them and saying, "Ah, they brought about their own problems, not my problem," or, "It has nothing to do with me, what about me?" Imagine if we gave someone, even someone we don't know, the sign of love instead of the finger. Imagine if instead of a lot of people thinking only of themselves, they lived with the spirit of giving from their heart. Imagine if we all lived with an attitude of gratitude for what we've received and were to share that with others. And many people do that. There's always more to do. And there are many people who don't. We've seen so many acts of senseless violence. Terrorists flying planes into skyscrapers and planting bombs at marathon finish lines. I think about all those horrible monsters who went into schools, churches, synagogues, theaters, shopping centers, carrying guns, opening fire, and killing or injuring all those totally innocent people, including teenagers and little children. Imagine for a moment what it would have been like if those cruel, selfish killers, wanting to make a statement of anger and hate, went into those schools instead of pulling out guns. They instead gave those children and the teachers this sign. And they said, "I give this to each of you in the spirit of caring, this gift with the hope that your lives will be filled with peace, joy, and lots of love. Please pass this gift along to others and treat each other with generosity, respect, and kindness." Imagine the input, imagine the impact that would have made on those teachers and students. Those angry, hurt-filled murderers who felt killing innocent people was the answer to their frustration would have been remembered in a much different way if they had done this instead of committing murder. They still would have affected the lives of others, but in a much different and a more positive way. What is happening around us in this country and in the world today clearly isn't working very well for most people. No matter how old or young you are, what religion you practice or not practice, your economic standing, your cultural background, your political affiliation, or whether you are single, divorced, or married, or straight, or gay, what we all share in common is that we all exist on this planet, at this time, together. We all breathe the same air, need food to eat, places to live, clothes to wear, and water to drink. The truth is, we all need each other. We need to understand that every life matters. Every person we meet has the potential to help change our lives, to help change them for the better. And you have the potential to do the same for someone else, even in the slightest of ways. Think about it. How do you want to be remembered? What's the impact you want to make in your part of the world with the people you know and those you've yet to meet? If you want to change the world, stop waiting for others to do it, especially politicians. You can do it right now. Make your life into something even more special. Save the world. It's really up to all of us. We close with a very nice song focused on the better things in life. It's called Dreams Do Come True, and it's performed by Rebecca Holden and Tony LeBron. It was produced by Rudy Perez and Joel Diamond. I think you'll get a lot out of this. Thank you all for watching. We'll catch you next time on Celebrate Life. Together.